Welcome to the third Tartarus Devlog. In this video, I'll discuss axis-aligned and object-oriented bounding boxes and illustrate how and why they're used. I'll also touch on a few key geometry-related concepts, like gift wrapping. Throughout, I'll demonstrate Tartarus's new bounding box functionality. In the second Tartarus devlog, we leveraged Tartarus's Entity Component System Architecture, or ECS, to animate entities using the transform component and a primitive physics system. The transform component will prove very useful throughout this video as we carve a path toward dynamic worlds and user interactivity. One of the key components that Tartarus will leverage for many future purposes are bounding boxes. In the demonstrations I've shown in prior videos, I've only used this orange triangle because it's a very simple polygon that's easy to work with and show. However, future editions may include more complex polygons or, in three dimensions, polyhedra. For example, in a future video, we'll probably see an implementation of the icosahedron, which is commonly used as a starting point for representing a sphere. Notice that this thing has 12 vertices and 20 faces. There are even larger polyhedra that can be very computationally expensive, especially for something like collision detection. We'll discuss collision detection in much more detail in a future video, but the idea is that we need to determine whether one entity is touching or intersecting with another. Now, there are some caveats to the rule, but generally, the more vertices, edges, and faces these entities have, the lengthier the computation is likely to be. Similarly, if we were talking about object picking, suppose I wanted to click on an on-screen object. I'd need to test whether the object's vertices enclose my cursor. Once again, with additional vertices, the calculation could take more time. For these reasons, there's a well-established approach called a bounding box that's often used to simplify these situations. Bounding boxes are essentially rectangular prisms used to approximate entities of an arbitrarily complex shape. Instead of dealing with all the vertices of an intricate statue, you can just treat it like a rectangular prism and potentially save a significant amount of computation time. But bounding boxes aren't just useful for complex objects, they're also useful for approximating any non-rectangular entity in a variety of applications. You see and experience an example of bounding box behavior all the time, or at least a flavor of it. The icons you click, like the close window button or even the icon for a specific application, you rarely need to click exactly inside the colorful icon to select it. Generally, there's a small square area surrounding the icon that makes it much easier to click or tap it. Although these might not actually be bounding boxes, they tangibly represent the idea of approximating things as rectangles. Now, to my knowledge, there are two types of dynamic bounding boxes used in game engines. The simpler but still effective axis-aligned bounding box, or AABB, and the slightly more sophisticated object-oriented bounding box, or OOBB. So, let's get a feel for what these different bounding boxes do. In the next few slides, I'll use the term object to refer to the entity that the bounding box is enclosing. As the name suggests, AABBs are axis-aligned, meaning that the faces of these rectangular prisms are always flush with the XY, YZ, and ZX planes. AABBs never rotate, hence they are axis-aligned. However, the position and dimensions of AABBs change to accommodate the object's shape and size. Therefore, if the object moves, the AABB translates appropriately in X, Y, or Z, but if the object rotates, the AABB will expand or contract to minimize its volume while still enclosing every feature of the object. These steps summarize the computation and update of an AABB, which I'll describe in two dimensions for simplicity, but note that this trivially extends to three dimensions. First, we need to determine the object's minimal and maximal X and Y coordinates. Then, we just need to assign the AABB's vertices using these values. But hang on a second. Consider what happens if one or more of an object's minimal and maximal coordinates are equal to one another. An obvious example in this 2D case would be a line whose width would be zero. In that case, our hypothetical bounding box's width would shrink to zero, and it really wouldn't be very useful in two dimensions. So, we can add an additional operation that ensures the width and height of the bounding box are greater than some minimum size. That way, our AABB always has some finite area and can always be rendered as a rectangle. But now, you might be wondering what an AABB is good for. If it doesn't even rotate with the object, it might seem kind of worthless. However, AABBs are particularly useful for what's called broad-phase collision detection. Once again, I'll probably cover that in a future video, but in summary, to avoid the precise but computationally expensive narrow phase collision detection, we want to use a very fast and simple method to determine whether two objects are even remotely close enough to interact. If they aren't, we can skip narrow phase detection and save time. AABBs are great for broad phase detection. I'll use this 2D example to illustrate. Suppose we have the blue and orange triangles in our world, and we just want to know whether they're close enough to interact. Well, we can just use a series of comparisons of their AABB coordinates to test this very quickly. We can see that in all these configurations, they're never close enough to interact except when one or more vertices of one AABB are enclosed by another AABB. Hence, one primary application of AABBs is a very rapid proximity test, although there may be other uses. So now, let's take a look at AABBs in action. Here, I'm going to overwhelm your senses with not one, not two, but three distinct objects, one of which, the cube on the right, is three-dimensional. When AABBs are enabled, watch what happens to their outlines. Note that these AABBs are actually three-dimensional, but because the boxes are axis-aligned and also because this scene is rendered with an orthographic view, we don't see the other vertices, edges, or faces of the boxes. But nonetheless, we see the AABBs stretching and compressing to accommodate the objects as they rotate. Also notice that for the 2D objects, I've implemented a minimum width, height, and depth to ensure the box volumes remain greater than zero. I've also configured the boxes so that they're always centered on the enclosed objects. Now, let's transition to OOBBs, which are fundamentally different from AABBs. The name provides an immediate distinguishing factor between the two. OOBBs are object-oriented, meaning they rotate with the object. Unlike AABBs, OOBBs have a fixed shape that travels with the object regardless of its position or orientation, whereas the AABB provides a minimum enclosing volume given the constraints that the box faces align with the coordinate planes. The OOBB is intended to provide a minimum enclosing volume overall. In other words, the ideal OOBB will be the smallest rectangular prism by volume in which the object fits. Unfortunately, computing OOBBs is significantly more involved than AABBs. First, we need to find each set of coplanar vertices, or each face of the object. Next, we calculate the mathematical planes defined by each face. After that, we separately project the object's vertices onto each of those planes. We'll then perform a step called gift wrapping. Let's take a moment to zoom in on this step. Essentially, gift wrapping allows us to find the set of vertices inside which all other vertices are located. For instance, a star has 10 vertices, but gift wrapping a star would produce a pentagon. We can see that the entirety of the star is contained within this pentagon, which defines what's called a convex hull. Like bounding boxes, convex hulls are useful for handling and treating a complex set of vertices as a potentially much simpler subset. Instead of needing to know where every vertex is located, we can just find the points that define the 2D perimeter or 3D surface and know with certainty that all the other vertices are contained within those edges or surfaces. So this gift wrapping step is basically a way for us to determine a 2D object's convex hull. Returning to our OOBB generation procedure, after we've found the convex hull for each set of projected vertices, we'll need to find the smallest rectangle that encloses each 2D convex hull. Then, we'll extrude each of these rectangles into rectangular prisms that encapsulate all the entity's vertices in three dimensions. Lastly, we'll choose the prism with the smallest volume and use that as our OOBB. And that's all there is to it. All joking aside, even though OOBBs are conceptually simple, implementing them is a fairly tedious process. I spent a couple weeks off and on trying to implement a bounding box component in Tartarus. So you might be wondering, why not avoid all the tedious code and just make a really huge box that's guaranteed to enclose each entity? We could do that, but it defeats the whole point. OOBBs are intended to represent the smallest volume that can enclose the object. If our boxes aren't actually minimally enclosing, then we're losing the really critical ability to approximate all our objects as rectangular prisms. With properly constructed OOBBs, no matter the shape, size, or orientations of our objects, we can always resort to treating them like boring old boxes if we need to. So, they may be laborious to implement, but they're well worth it. Now, let's take a look at OOBBs in action. Once again, I'll use the triangle, square, and cube to demonstrate. When OOBBs are enabled, watch what happens to their outlines. Notice that they don't stretch or compress like AABBs, but reorient with the objects. Just like before, I've implemented a minimum width, height, and depth, and enforced that the boxes are always centered on their enclosed objects. Like I said just moments ago, the advantage is that we can now pretend that all three of the objects are rectangular prisms if we so desire. Here's a video of the same exact thing, but now the bounding box faces are filled in. At this point, unless you saw the previous video in which the box faces were transparent, you'd have no idea that these boxes enclose objects with very different shapes and dimensions. Therein lies the point. In a variety of situations, including collision detection, even if we have complex shapes, we can treat them like simple prisms if we wish. So, while we use AABBs for broad-phase collision detection, we can use OOBBs for what I'll tentatively call mid-phase collision detection. Slightly more precise, yet still computationally inexpensive. As I mentioned earlier, these bounding boxes are implemented using a new bounding box component. This means that with Tartarus's ECS, we can trivially assign an AABB, OOBB, or both to any object we want. Now, big picture, this may not seem like too impressive of an advancement, and I'd concede that that's probably true. However, a good portion of the machinery required to generate these bounding boxes, especially gift wrapping, will prove very useful in implementing other, more exciting features like object picking in the near future. Hint hint, nudge nudge. Thanks for watching. I'm excited for the continued momentum on this project and look forward to future progress. If you enjoyed this content, I'd appreciate a like and your subscription if you want to stay up to date on this Devlog series. I've really appreciated all your feedback and encouragement so far, so please continue leaving your comments along with your ideas and suggestions on what features or content you'd like to see in a future Devlog video. Until next time, remember that people often forget what you say, but rarely forget how you make them feel.